My journey to Isla Juan Fernandez was easy compared to Alexander Selkirk's. Put up with a cramped 11 hours in a Delta 767 from Atlanta to Santiago. Enjoy in-flight food, a beautiful sunrise, and the attention of the flight attendant. After an uneventful flight, check into the luxurious Holiday Inn across from the terminal, dine, and snooze. The next morning, walk 50 meters to the terminal and buy a ticket for the turboprop to the island.
Fíjense, hay un dormir, ¿eh? ¿Cuál es ese aerocardal? Tiene varios dormir.
Aerocardal, mira.
Sí. How was your flight?
From Estados Unidos?
Yeah.
Horrible. It seats and economy. Cramped.
Like by Delta or American?
Delta, but Delta. Still, I couldn't sleep. So, Alvaro, how many hours do you have in these Beechcraft?
In this?
Si.
About 800.
Muy buenos días. Plataforma Papa. Activando plan de vuelo y lista la puesta en marcha.
Each turboprop on the Super King develops over 900 horsepower. When I made the reservations for the flight, I asked Maria if I could sit right behind the pilots so I could shoot video out the window. And she said there would be no co-pilot and I was welcome to sit in the right-hand seat. Unbelievable. Gotta love those relaxed Chilean regulations. Prior to his job with Aerolineas ATA, Alvaro had been a pilot in the Chilean Air Force.
Upgrade the cabina en año. O sea, las
este como
los papeles.
After nearly a year of anticipation, wheels up and westbound for Isla Robinson Crusoe, 300 miles off the coast. Heading due west, about 30 miles from the coast. The terrain around Santiago reminds me of southwest United States. Semi-arid, brown mountains, patchwork farms. By the time we reach the Valparaiso, Chile's major seaport, we are already at about 15,000 feet and still climbing steadily. ...300 miles of empty sky and ocean to cross. Infinite, blue, fascinating. I had not taken the time to check out the specifications of the Beechcraft Super King before we left, so I was quite surprised to learn that we would be cruising at 27,000 feet. And naturally, that meant the cabin was pressurized and we had oxygen. About 160 miles out, Alvaro asked me to be quiet because he had to check in when we were over waypoint Morsa. For this, he used an Iridium satellite phone.
Alfa Charlie Victor, seguido por
bolsa, ¿de qué bolsa la suma?
440, vamos.
440, 450. Tenemos aproximadamente como 40 nudos.
Hola, Miguel.
Hi, hey there.
I am so happy.
Good, good. Beautiful. Are you going to land the craft?
No way, man. Alvaro.
Very easy.
Alvaro is the man.
Okay. Five petition y eso todo.
Eso todo. Solo tenemos dos King 200 y un King 90 y un navajo también.
Yeah. ¿Qué pasó yo con el dormier que tenía?
Ese lo tenía antiguamente Laza, ahora de Corpus Light, pero no viene mucho para acá.
Yeah.
No viene casi nunca. Más lento.
Y esto de 320 kilómetros por hora, ¿no?
Ahora vamos con 500 libras por hora, o sea, 250
libras. 250 libras, o sea, son como...
Son 500 libras.
This ice was on the inside of the window, not on the exterior. About 30 miles out from the island, we started our descent. Alvaro backed off on the throttles and set the autopilot altitude for 1,500 feet. Those clouds below us were not right on the surface of the water, which is what I had initially assumed, but at about 10,000 feet. Finally, the first glimpse of the isla peeking out from a hole in the clouds. The island, surreal, glowing softly, rose before me out of the water. I was familiar with all its contours and topography from weeks of Google Earth sessions, but this was real and was finally here. I was enthralled. Here we're passing due south of La Piramide, the highest point on the island, with an elevation of 4,358 feet. The tiny airstrip is on the far western end of the island, the only place flat enough. It runs roughly north-south. At this point, we were on the 45 to downwind leg of the approach. A few months after my visit, a twin-engine Chilean Air Force transport crashed, attempting to land on the island in rainy, windy conditions. 15 passengers, including the popular Chilean TV presenter Felipe Camiroaga, and 6 crew were killed when the 26-year-old female pilot made a third approach after 2 aborts. Although the CASA 212 aircraft has a poor operational record, I believe the pilot exercised bad judgment by trying to land in marginal conditions. I suspect pressure to deliver the Buenos Dias a Todos television team on time for their live documentary contributed to the decision to make the third attempt. A more experienced pilot would have returned to the mainland. As we lined up for final approach, everything started to seem a lot less surreal. At both ends of the runway, 500-foot cliffs dropped into the Pacific. Come in too low, and the face of the cliff would be the last thing we saw. Too high, and we'd have to abort to avoid skidding off the far end.
Was it recording?
Yes,
it was recording. Okay, good. Ah, smell of the ocean. It's nice. So, maybe you're not someone I need to torture with my bad Spanish?
No.
Where are y'all from?
Maine.
We're on a research project.
We're looking at the tsunami impacts.
We've gone up to the Mirador,
yeah,
which is
over on, there,
on the trail to...
Alvaro is a great pilot. He talked a lot and joked during the flight, but when things were serious, he got quiet and he was really focused.
Actually here. I can't believe that I'm actually here.